φυσικές μας όρους της βιολογίας, ειδικά της δομικής βιολογίας, και σου λυθήκατε νομίζω με κάποια θέματα που άπτονται με βρανικό πρωτεϊνό και υπολογισμούς πάνω σε αυτές τις, πάνω σε αυτά τα θέματα. Είναι θέματα ιδιαίτερα ενδιαφέροντα και πολλές φορές δύσκολα να τα προσεγγίσει κανείς με πειραματικές μεθόδους, οπότε οι οικολογικές μέθοδοι είναι μέθοδοι που κερδίζουν διαρκώς έδαφος σε αυτή την περιοχή. Μετά την περίοδο της Οξφόρδης, συνέχισε στο Πανεπιστήμιο του Λίτς στην Αγγλία και στη συνέχεια στο Πανεπιστήμιο στο South Florida, νομίζω έτσι, όπου
simulate from systems that consist of few atoms, like small organic molecules, up to systems that are like a whole virus capsid. And in time scales, that means we can simulate, we can model events that sort of start from bone vibration up to large protein domain motions that occur in the millisecond or microsecond timescale. So basically, we're talking about three basic themes. The first is an example of what we call structure-based methods, which is basically docking, molecular docking, and a version of the docking that I'm going to talk about, called virtual screening. Then I'm going to talk a little bit more about some methods that take us beyond a single static protein structure. And these are molecular, some types of molecular simulations. And then, towards the end, if I have the time, I'll try to introduce you to some simulations that have sort of specially developed methods to model larger systems and more rare events, so larger space and time scales. So, of course, one of the most fundamental problems in biology is the binding of a ligand and a protein. We know that the ligand is sort of a small molecule compared to the protein. It can be organic, it can be a peptide that binds to the protein. It's stabilized through a series of intermolecular interactions. These are usually hydrogen bonds. These are all electrostatic in nature, and they are hydrogen bonds, and they can be different types of other types of electrostatic interaction, like ion dipole or dipole dipole. They can also be dispersion interactions as well. In order to find a ligand that binds tightly to a protein, this is a problem that basically in pharmaceutical industry. And the pipeline, the procedure to find ligands that can be used as pharmaceutical agents is shown here. So we have the stages of target validation, target definition, target validation, which are pretty straightforward nowadays. But then we have to identify, as we call a lead compound, from a sample, from a collection of 28 million currently known ligands. And this is not a trivial task at all. And so when we have selected these few ligands that can act minimum activity for what we wanted to do, then there are multiple cycles of lead optimization. In this last stage of the process, we try to increase the potency of these compounds. And finally, the long we have FDA approved drugs. This is, as you probably understand, a quite long and very costly years to have what's called new molecular entity in the market, and the cost is probably, this is all outdated by now, it's at least $1 billion. So how we can accelerate this process? By using some techniques that are collectively known as rational drug discovery. It is rational because we use the information, sort of the structure of the ligand, the protein, and of course the complex between the two. So we use the information that is sort of here in the structure and how these protein and the ligand interact. And on basis of this information, we try to find new ligands and make them sort of more potent. One case of the protein that we're interested to inhibit is the ALP2-3 complex. It's very important because it nucleates the formation of actin filaments. So this is a very basic, a very fundamental cellular activity. So this protein is basically involved in many cellular functions. Currently, because it's so important, there are no reliable, no reliable methods to inhibit it in vivo. So we want to find small molecule inhibitors that can inhibit this protein, and also to use them as a potential anti-cancer agents, because it's known that this protein is involved in metastasis during cell migration, and it's overexpressed in many cancers, in cancer cell lines. Of course, we don't begin from scratch. Our collaborators from the University of Oregon, United States, have run a standard high throughput screening of a small commercial database of 400,000 compounds. And from this standard screening exercise, two inhibitors on the sort of low micromolar range activity were identified. So that's about 0.0005% success rate. Nevertheless, our collaborator saw the crystal structure of the ARP23 complex with these two ligands, with these two inhibitors, and he found that the other one of them, CK636, binds to the interface between the two domains, ARP2 and ARP3 domains of the complex, whereas the other one binds to another allosteric pocket, which is in ARP3 domain. I forgot to say that ARP2 and ARP3 domain are highly homologous protein, highly homologous to actin, and this is sort of part of the function of this protein, and because they form the pseudoactin dimer that acts as a nucleus of the neural filament. So what we did is basically a high-throughput docking. So in docking, you know that we have a protein structure and we have a ligand that we're trying to sort of make it bind in a particular pocket. Now, in our case, it was the first pocket that I showed in the previous slide. We explore different conformations in the particular binding pocket, different conformations of the ligand. We score them using an empirical scoring function, and we use the best one, the best pose that has the highest score as the lead. And then if you do that for many compounds in a row, it's basically called visual screening. So the visual screening workflow that we used is based on the commercially available docking program GLIDE. And basically what we do is we take about 2 million compounds from the Zinc database and about 24,000 compounds from the main grid database, and we dock them using the single precision scoring function, which is sort of, it's a function that captures only the most fundamental physicochemical characteristics of the interactions between the ligand and the protein. And from the first stage, we keep about 40,000 and about 10,000 in each case, 10,000 compounds, and then we redock these compounds using a more accurate scoring function, so extra precision, before we end up with 1,000 in the case of the Zinc and 100 top glide hits in terms of the docking score. Then we have, after this, we do some post-processing, we do some structural similarity clustering in order to choose from these 1,000 or 100 compounds that are sort of unique in structure. And from these 10, then from that, something like 10 clusters, we select one compound for assaying. Sort of, in total, we have like 10 compounds that are sent for a biochemical assay. And in this particular biochemical assay, it's designed sort of to measure the polymerization rate of actin by decreasing the fluorescence of the pyrene-labeled actin subunits. So this is like the curves that you get over time for different concentrations of the compound that we're assaying. And this is the same curve for different concentrations. So from these 10 compounds that we sent for assaying, the two compounds were found to be good inhibitors. That means an IC50 value of less than 50 micromolar. Three were found to be moderate inhibitors with an activity between 50 and 100 micromolar. And six were rather poor inhibitors with an IC50 value of larger than 100 micromolar.
KT constants to fluorescence experiments?
No, it's not the KT, it's the IC50, it's the half maximal concentration.
But you calculate it from the fluorescence experiment?
Yes, that's right. From fitting a Hill equation.
So this is sort of
the equation. Yes, yes. It's sort of fitting the data. Yes, you get just a parameter that's the IC50. Yes. So the bottom line here is that from all these sort of 10, 11 compounds, two are found to be good inhibitors, and that's about 20% success, which is not too great, but it's really much more substantial than the 0.0005% that I showed, that the success rate achieved by the standard high throughput screen. This is just the structure of one of these diagrams, the structure inside the binding pocket that we study. So here we show we call it Maybridge 006 compound. So it shows superimposed with the CK636 or CK666, which is actually a derivative of the compound of one of the original inhibitors. And you can see that it sort of superimposes quite well. It also sort of forms various hydrogen bonds in the same binding pocket of the protein. Of course, visual screening is a valuable tool. I mean, it's fast and cost effective, and it's useful in eliminating active from inactive compounds. But it also has some limitations, as you probably know, as you can imagine. The most important ones are the ones that I show here. It's based on a static structure, so the protein structure doesn't change throughout the docking of a single ligand or any ligand. So it ignores any kind of induced fit effects that you may have when the ligand binds to the protein. It also doesn't care about the presence of a solvent, except in a very implicit and indirect way that I cannot explain right now. But it doesn't take care of explicit water molecules during binding, which may play a crucial role. And finally, the scoring function that we use to score the ligands that we dock is sort of empirical in nature. So there is a need to use more realistic, more physical chemical models than the ones that are used in visual screening. And these models, most of all, have to take into account the molecular flexibility, the fact that biomolecules, proteins, DNA, whatever, are flexible, are not just, obviously, not static structures. So you know, obviously, that from a protein sequence, you have a particular function through a very well-defined three-dimensional structure, as the one shown here. Of course, this is not totally true, because this structure mediates the function through dynamics. So whatever the protein is doing because it's a flexible molecule. It's called a flexible molecule, and because it's different domains, different loops, different parts of the molecule move, this is responsible for whatever function this molecule is doing. There are two types of simulations that we can use to model flexibility. One is Monte Carlo simulations, the other one is molecular dynamic simulations. In Monte Carlo is historically the first type of simulation that was developed to study a molecular system. It generates certain configurations of the system in study by making certain changes to the position of the atoms of the molecules that we study. The system consists of. And then, if the energy of this new configuration is lower, then it's automatically accepted. If it's higher, then we calculate the so-called Boltzmann factor, that is this expression here, and it's then this Boltzmann factor compared to a random number between 0 and 2. If it's larger than this random number, then the state is retained. If it's not retained, it's objective. If it's smaller, it's retained. And the result of this process is that we have a chain of Markov states, so it's the state that depends only on the immediately previous state, and not of any other in the past. And the limiting distribution that we achieve by generating configurations using this criteria is the usual Boltzmann distribution that we want to sample. And after we generate a few thousand, 100,000 configurations, we can use this well-known formula from thermodynamics to calculate whatever thermodynamic properties or observables we want. The Monte Carlo is fast because it doesn't depend on the calculation of on the integration of any kind of or the calculation of velocities. So you can have up to 10 to 10 speed up with some clever generation of the new configurations. And it's used, not in, in simulations per se, but it's in different kind of computational methods. Like it's used as an optimization method in docking or in the novel structure prediction, as an example which I show here, so peptide docking in a protein pocket. And here the sampling of the different configurations of the peptide inside the pocket is done by Monte Carlo. So for this type of problem, Monte Carlo can do just fine, but for larger molecules with a significant number of internal degrees of freedom, like protein to DNA or protein to DNA complexes, Monte Carlo has apparent problems. The problem is that a little change in the internal degrees of freedom of the protein can generate a very large change in the overall structure of the protein. And this may result in an overlap, in overlaps between protein atoms and protein and water atoms. And these will be rejected by this criteria that I show here. And as a result, you don't manage to get any sampling. So the alternative, and actually the basic way, the most fundamental way to simulate the dynamics of the protein is molecular dynamic simulations. The components of this method is basically a molecular model that we take from X-ray or NMR. And then we have a potential energy function that we use to calculate the forces interaction between atoms in the system. We impose certain boundary conditions because we want to simulate conditions of a solution. We don't want to simulate protein that hit the wall of the box, which is something unphysical. And also we want a method to generate successive configurations of atoms, like Monte Carlo, but in a different way. What way? So first we have, just to show you in brief how we set up molecular dynamics simulations, we have a structure model that we get from established molecular biology techniques, X-ray, NMR. And then we place it in a rectangular or any other shape box of water molecules. Then we add some counter ions to neutralize the total charge of the protein and also to achieve the sufficient salt concentration that is biologically relevant, anything between 50 and 150 millimolar. And then, of course, they have to do some energy minimizations to get rid of the steric clashes inside the protein or in the bulk water, because the bulk water here is created sort of in an artificial way. So we have to lower the energy of the system before we start the actual and molecular dynamic simulation. So once we're ready to do that, the first step is to assign initial velocities of all atoms from a Maxwell Boltzmann distribution that corresponds to the particular temperature that we want to study, basically 310 Kelvin. And then we calculate the forces on all atoms using the potential energy function that we have. And then using an integration scheme that I won't describe in much detail, we calculate the velocities and the coordinates of all atoms by basically integrating the second law of Newton. And we do that for, well, as many times as we can. So for 100 million times of integration, we get the dynamics of something like 200 nanoseconds. Okay, so you get something like this. So what is the advantage of doing molecular dynamics? I mean, the most apparent advantage is that you actually visualize what's going on inside the protein or around the protein at very, very high resolution, at atomic resolution. I mean, can't get any higher. And this can give us many insights into whatever biomolecular function we are studying. So for example, here is an aquaporin, a membrane protein that transports water molecules from one side of the membrane to the other. And molecular dynamic simulations allow us to see how exactly the molecules are conducted through this pore and how they interact with the walls of this pore and how the dipole moment changes when they pass from the upper half to the lower half of the protein and so on. What kind of things did we get from the simulations? First is for, of course, that time series of different observables. For example, root mean square deviation as a function of time. We can get interatomic distances between any group of atoms that we're interested in as a function of time. We can also monitor hydrogen bonds as a function of time and so on. We can also calculate time average quantities like B factors and particle densities that are also useful for the study of paramolecular function. We can also calculate using statistical mechanics formalism different kind of macroscopic properties. By far the most important in structural molecular biology is the free energy change between A and B states that I show the formula here. This is just an example of a microscopic property that we can calculate from the molecular dynamic simulation. So here I just show the distance between particular ATP atoms and protein atoms inside one of the R2-3 complex binding pockets. Okay, so you can see how this. Distances change over time. So if they break or if they stay formed throughout the simulation, and of course you can have plots of this type. So this is the distance in nanometers as a function of time in nanoseconds. Here is an example of time average quantity, time average observable, the B factors. The B factors, we probably know that are related with the degree of fluctuations. So here I just show the X-ray structure of the R2-3 complex colored with B factors that are solved from the X-ray. And here I show the same structure, but colored according to the B factors that we calculate from the simulation. Okay, you can see here that the flexibility that we see from the simulation is quite different than from a single structure. So for example, you can see here that these are to be from X-ray. Okay, this is just an empty simulation of R2-3 complex without anything else present except water. And here is from a simulation that you also have some peptide activators and active monomers that we believe to play an important role in the activation of the complex. And we see that these two components induce some even more flexibility in the protein. So because MD simulation can be used to relate structure to function through dynamics, they can basically be applicable to most or all problems of structural biology. This can be structural relaxation and refinement that I won't talk about today. They can be used to study enzyme catalysis mechanisms. But here, because we have the formation and the breaking of bonds, the simulation have to be combined in a certain way with quantum mechanics. So these simulations are known as QM, quantum mechanics, molecular mechanics. Molecular dynamics, of course, is most widely used to study conformational changes of proteins, so how conformation of proteins changes through time and in different environments. It also studies protein ligand and protein protein interactions. Very importantly, study mechanisms for protein allostery. So the simulations are used to identify states that usually not or almost never detectable by usual by techniques like NMR or X-ray. Also, protein, we can study protein translocation as we're going to talk, and membrane transport as well. The first example is protein ligand interactions. As I mentioned in the beginning, we have the stage of lead optimization. We have a lead compound that has some activity, like 12 micromolar, and we want to increase that as much as possible. So what we do is we replace hydrogens in different places of the molecule with groups like chloride, methyl, fluoride, and so on. Of course, this can take quite a while if you do it in a lab, but in a computer it's quite easy, it's quite trivial. And how do you test for the binding of these new ligands? We use a technique called free energy perturbation calculations. So our starting point is this formula, the Swanzig formula for the to calculate the free energy between, in general, two states. And in our problem, in order to calculate the relative binding free energies, we devise a simple thermodynamic cycle. As you know, free energy is a state function, so it doesn't depend on the steps that we use to calculate it. So in this state, in this particular problem, we use, you see here, we transform, alchemically transformed ligand A to ligand B in water. And we do the same transformation inside the binding pocket, okay? So if you work out the algebra, okay, by assuming that, you know, assuming that all the sum of all these three energies is zero, you see that the relative energy of binding of the new compound B relative to compound A equals the difference of free energy transform of these two transformations. Okay. And if this delta delta G is negative, then the new compound is predicted to be favored with respect to binding. It's a better binder than A. If it's larger than zero, then it's predicted to be worse binder. So this is just to show you the system that we set up for this type of calculations. It's a reduced model of the protein, so everything beyond 23 angstroms were, you know, chopped off. This is just basically to reduce the number of atoms. And this reduced model was evaluated in a spherical water cup, and only side chains close to a 10 angstrom radius from the ligand were allowed to sort of move around. And this, because the system was small, we were able to do the sampling of the state with Monte Carlo. So here is the compound that we want to optimize. And here is all the sum of the substitutions in different parts of the molecule and the calculated delta delta G values. You can see here that quite happily that, you know, some of these compounds were predicted rightly to be more active than the pilot compound. So, you know, they had negative delta delta G values compared to the pilot compound, so they predicted to be more active. And indeed, the IC50 suggests so. But also, we managed to predict the worst binders. So, for example, these two compounds, for which we calculated large positive delta delta G values, indeed, the IC50 turned out to be quite low. I mean, quite high, but that means high IC50 means, as you know, low activity. As I said, molecular dynamics is very widely used to study conformational changes of protein. This is again the RP2-3 complex. So from a molecular dynamic simulation, what you get is a picture like this. So you see all kinds of, you know, all kinds of motions happening at the same time. So important and non-important, large scale and quick, and also motions that are related to noise. Of course, this trajectory can give you quite a bit of information, but it would be great if we can filter this trajectory in a certain way so we can extract the large-scale motions. So these motions that account for these fluctuations that we see here the most. And the way to do that is by performing the principal component analysis. It's an analysis that is used in statistical analysis as well. It's actually taken from there. So in this way, we extract the large-scale motions from this simulation trajectory, and it's shown very clearly. For example, the first principal component that accounts for, let's say, 30% of the total fluctuation, it looks like this. Okay, so you can see here, you know, only those motions that are sort of important for this particular component. And the second component that accounts for another 20% of the total fluctuations, you can see other types of motions of the protein domains. Okay. So in this way, you can see, you can see more clearly how the protein changes shape during simulation. Because, of course, as I said, standard can simulate events up to a microsecond time scale. This is only for a relatively small size of systems. They cannot capture biochemical processes that occur in longer time scales, like conformational changes that I mentioned. So in this case, we need to use MD techniques that make use of what is called enhanced sampling methods, okay, that get around this problem. The enhanced sampling methods basically allow us to simulate conformational changes or other types of biological processes that happen in the microsecond scale to study them in a sort of a nanosecond scale. That's in the scale that is accessible by modern simulations. The common feature of all these methods is the introduction of a biasing energy term. Okay. So we introduce a bias into the simulation to accelerate whatever process we are interested in. Okay, these have different types of names. Don't bother to remember them now, all of them. But as I said, you know, you have the umbrella sampling, steered MD, targeted MD, metadynamics, or whatever. But in all of them, the bottom line to remember is that the bias is suitably collected, what's called collective variable. Collective variable is a term you probably are familiar. It's basically a reaction coordinate. Reaction coordinate is the actual name of the reaction coordinate in molecular dynamic simulation. So it's a generalized coordinate. It's a function of the Cartesian coordinates of the system that describe the progress of a particular biochemical process. And this can be typically, I mean, the distance between two groups of atoms. For example, here, reactants, two reactants. But it can also be a reduced deviation that sort of shows you the shape of the protein, or the root mean square deviation, and many others. So here I just show example of the use of these reaction coordinates. If you calculate the free energy of the system as a function of only one of these reaction coordinates, then you get what's called potential of mean force, which is very, very informative and very, very enlightening of a particular biomolecular process. So here, for example, we have a reaction coordinate. This is the separation between two protein molecules. And you can see here the corresponding free energy profile, which is one-dimensional potential mean force. You can see that a particular separation, we have a minimum. So at that moment, at that separation, the binding is most tight, and then sort of increases as the protein get further from each other. You can also have a two-dimensional potential mean force. Here in protein folding simulations, you have free energy profiles that are they are plotted as a function of the radius of gyration of the peptide and the RMSD of the peptide. Okay, and you can see the sort of the basins of these in these plots, or other regions of these plots correspond to structurally defined states of the biomolecule. Okay, so just to remind you, we try to study the conformational change of this large macromolecular complex, the RP3 complex. We know that by itself is in an inactive state, and this state has been solved by X-ray. In this state, the RP2 and RP3 domains are sort of further splayed apart, and through activation, they come together. They actually move about 30 angstroms relative to one another to form the actin diamond that you see in actin filament structures, okay, the short pitches, called the short pitch conformation. And this is a model of the protein that's actually not by X-ray, but it's actually produced by docking this structure into the electron microscopy map of an active filament branch action where this protein is supposed to be in the active form. So the type of simulation that we used here is called stereo molecular dynamics. Again, the reason is because it's difficult to observe the conformation changes in, you know, in using a standard MD techniques. In stereo molecular dynamics, we introduce mechanical forces somewhere in the system to accelerate the conformational change or any other biomolecular process. Okay, and this the XR here in the harmonic energy term is a suitable collective variable. When the RM is D, so when the RM is D of the inactive state relative to, let's say, active or target state is selected as a reaction coordinate, then basically the steered MD becomes what is known as targeted MD. And this is what we used to study in detail the whole conformational change of this complex in a few nanoseconds of simulation. This is just a very quick video that my colleague Spiros Vikatos made for the supercomputer that we actually run these calculations. So we the starting structure for this, the starting structure, no, this is just so we start from the inactive state with all the with the ARP, the three and ARP2 domains splayed apart. Okay. This is just where the show where the active two activating peptides bind. Okay, they're supposed to trigger this activation. And now you have the TMD simulation where you just they move to one another. These two domains move to one another. Sorry, I'm just showing you. So again, we start with inactive state, with these two domains separated. Okay. The activators, okay. This is just to show the people, to show the people there what we did. And this is, you see how they move toward another to form the sockets time. And this is the active state at the end of actually 4 nanoseconds of molecular dynamics. This is just the snapshots, every 5 nanosecond snapshots for the 20 nanosecond simulation. And this, from this type of simulation, you can get a TMD force profile, so the force that actually exercised by the algorithm to reduce the RMSD between the starting structure and the target structure. And you can see here from, we start from an RMSD of like 9.8, 9.7 angstrom. And until 4, the TMD force is sort of more or less stable. But then, after, let's say, 3 angstrom of RMSD, it starts increasing, well, in absolute value. And this, we believe, this is an indication of a possible intermediate state. But in order to ensure that we sample an intermediate state, we obviously want to run much longer than 20 nanoseconds. Not much longer, but longer than 20 nanoseconds. Okay, this is just an example, another example of MD study, the effect of the translock on confinement of the folding free energy of the peptide. This protein, as you know, is responsible for conducting peptides from one side of the periplasmic membrane to the other. So here they used an enhanced sampling technique that I won't describe in detail to study how the folding free energy changes as a function of the helicity of the peptide and the position of the peptide inside the channel. So here they just show the projection of the free energy profile as a function of the helicity of the peptide for different locations. And they show that they resemble all of these profiles resemble the free energy profile of the peptide inside water. Okay, so in all profiles you see that there are two defined structural states, the alpha helix and an extended state, okay? But they see that inside the peptide, inside the channel, the barrier, the energy barrier between these two states is much larger. So the time that you need, that the peptide needs to transition from one state to the other is much longer. Here is also another projection of the free energy. This time is the free energy as a function of the translocation distance. Okay, translocation distance. And they see that there is a clear minimum in the case of, when this size 3.4, this means we have the helical peptide, okay? So helical peptide, what's the free energy of the helical peptide in different positions along the pore? This is the black curve. And what is the free energy along the pore of an extended peptide? This is the red curve, okay? You can see that somewhere in the here, in this position, you have a clear minimum of the helical peptide. And they actually tried, they conclude that it's the polar inner surface of the translocon that stabilizes the alpha helical state. Okay, so the standard in these simulations, we can reach, I mean, for a small system, we can reach up to microsecond timescale, and we can go, again, with not up to a microsecond, but for a few nanoseconds, we can simulate systems that reach a size of like 10 nanometers. So if we try to exceed these scales, of course, it becomes very computationally expensive. One way to get around this is the enhanced sampling methods that I mentioned. Another way is to use coarse-grained models. What's a coarse-grained model? It's probably, you can get the idea here. So you basically, in the DPPC lipid molecules, the DPPC lipid molecule that we use to construct models of lipid barriers, we replaced about 130 atoms of the lipid molecule with 12 particles that have similar properties. So we have four types of particles: hydrophobic, hydrophilic, non-polar, and charged. So you end up with a DPPC lipid molecule that only consists of 12 particles. So there are two advantages here. One is that, of course, we have a small number of atoms in the system, but also we have much larger integration times there. Okay, because we have we don't have hydrogens anymore, we can go much higher in the integration time step, and with the same number of integration steps, we can simulate the dynamics of, let's say, microseconds or tens of microseconds. Of course, one type of test for this type of model is that it's a lipid bilayer that's constructed by this type of lipids. Is this bilayer that's made of this type of lipids can be formed by an empty simulation? The answer is that it can. So you can see after sort of a few hundreds of nanoseconds the formation of the lipid bilayer and sort of separation from water. Water here is modeled as a single sphere. Here again. So this is one test. Other tests, more quantitative tests, have been made that show that this is a reliable model for membrane systems, for membrane protein systems. Just a few of them. Just a few applications of the coarse-grained in the applications. Some of them have already been mentioned in the previous slides. So there are applications that standard atomistic and deep can be applied to, like membrane protein linearization, so on, self-assembly of soluble peptides and proteins. But this method is really very powerful to study systems that contain membrane proteins. In these systems, that we have a really large number of atoms if we model them atomistically. Most important, so for example, we have membrane protein linearization that we can follow in very much detail in this model. We have the study of pore formation by antimicrobial peptides. We have the design of drug and gene delivery system. This is basically nanoparticles that we can see how they interact, how the pyramid will be by layers. And also we have something like it's called membrane fusion. It's something that's totally out of the scope of atomistic energy. An example is one of these applications here is protein, membrane protein oligomerization. So we start with here with two integrin transmembrane helices that are 60 angstroms apart at the beginning of the simulation, and after like 500 nanoseconds, they come together and they form the well-known helical heterodimer that is very, very, very close to the NMR structure solved of this heterodimer. Another example is the assembly of a TM domain in the T-cell receptor complex. This is the T-cell receptor complex. And this is the third helix that we place quite far from the complex, and then at the end of the simulation they come together and they form this well-defined complex that we can test. I mean, we can test if this is true by, you know, devising certain experiments and so on. This is just a quick slide just to show you that this model is capable of. This is the SEC, the translocon complex. All components of the translocon are present, and they try to model what the effect of different cross-leaking environments in the mobility of something that's called the plug looping, the small helix that comes in and out and allows the pore to be open and closed. And finally, as I said, the membrane fusion, so it's a type of phenomenon that is totally out of the scope of standard MD. So in this study, coarse grain in these simulations can show very, very high detail how a coil-coil snare complex, so a protein complex that we know is capable of facilitating fusion, can mediate this thing in four defined stages. Okay, so I hope to show you that structure-based methods like screening or phenogenic perturbation can greatly accelerate lead identification and optimization. Molecular dynamics simulation is a very powerful tool in establishing structure-function relationships in anatomic detail, and they are able to simulate systems from small peptide up to large protein complexes with more than 1,000 residues. They are also able to simulate membrane protein systems as well. And also show you that increased computational power that, you know, is available in very large supercomputer clusters of many thousand CPUs, and also advances in simulation methods allow the modeling of quite rare biochemical events in quite reasonable computational time. Just to thank my postdoctoral supervisor at the College of Athens, my collaborators at the group, Spiridon, Evi, and Harry. Collaborators in the University of Patras for helping us with the synthesis of the compounds that we suggested from free energy perturbation equations, and our collaborators in the University of Oregon who helped us with actually performed the biochemical assays of this synthesized compound. And thank you for your attention.
I'm impressed how far along biophysics has come. I'm a physicist and did not know, but really, physics and biology now are close relatives.
Yeah.
So that was a comment. My question is, undoubtedly, your calculations require heavy computing.
Yes.
Yeah. Very demanding computing.
Yeah.
Does the Academy of Athens have a supercomputer?
Where it has a small supercomputer. It has like it has bought like individual nodes, like Mac machines, and it has connected with them, standard Ethernet connection. This is the cluster they made, but because it's not a standard Ethernet connection, it's not a high bandwidth that we want. We can only use single node at a time, so like 12 processors. We have, so, or 24 threads, if you like. We can't use more than 20, like, we can't use the two nodes at the same time because they cannot communicate in a high speed. It's you know, that you have in standard supercomputing clusters. So and we have to apply for computing time in other clusters.
Where do we get computing time?
We have applied in three supercomputing centers. One is the, called the PRAISE, it is the supercomputing infrastructure in Europe. They have large supercomputers in quite a few countries. The one we use is in France. It's called Curie. It has like, I don't know, 48,000 cores. We also use the Cytera supercomputer in Cyprus. But it's more easy to get time there. It's smaller, obviously, than the Curie. Curie is the largest, one of the largest computers in Europe. It is available with this high bandwidth that I mentioned. So it's Cytera in Cyprus, and also something called HPC. It's a supercomputing infrastructure for Southeastern Europe.
Okay.
So there are supercomputers in Hungary, in Serbia, that we can use for this type of applications.
Something that is not very clear to me is how do you take into account with all this computational analysis the oligomeric state of the protein that is involved in the analysis, for example, set Y, set A, that is not that they probably act as dimers or even tetramers. How will that change?
It does
change.
The free energy of the nascent nucleotide chain. Yeah, it does change. Yeah, it's true. Yes, it's true. But the R2C complex, we know that it doesn't dimerize. It doesn't form dimers. So we only know that it forms complexes with these peptide activators and active ones. So we have run simulations of these complexes as well.
I'm talking specifically about why.
This is not something we run.
I know that there is a big whole committee of this SEC translocon.
Yes.
Has this.
I know from the other system.
I'm
not familiar with the SEC system. I'm familiar with the aquaporin. Aquaporin is like the.
Yeah. I'm talking about the experiment where you measure the energy that is required while the nascent nucleotide chain is moving through the channel.
Yeah. So the way to take into account is that. Basically, you start the simulation with the oligomeric state.
I mean, can you change the oligomeric state?
Yes, of course.
Virtually have like values.
The way I know how to do it is that you take the asymmetric unit, right, of the it's available, and then that is usually a monomer. So you apply some crystallographic operations. Symmetry operations to construct the actual oligomeric state that was solved.
Okay.
This is how you do it. This is how I know how to do it.
Even the structure that was solved is not always the functional state of the
body. That's right.
That's why I'm trying to understand how all these can be applied in the real life.
If it's not available, then we have to do some other thing. We have to somehow put the monomers so quite close to one another, in the membrane, and then lead them to equilibrate into the sort of oligomeric state that we want them to study as a main system. Okay.
I mean, I could just make a remark that, however, in many, many, many cases, the structure that is crystallized is also biologically perfectly active, and you can therefore activity, enzymatic activity inside the crystal, so you can see all these dynamic phenomena if you have the proper experimental technique.
Yeah, in many cases it is, but not always.
For the GARPIT-MD, do you have to know the initial and final structure to do
it? Yes.
That's how the forces are applied.
Yes. You have to know, or you start from whatever structure you want. Basically, we don't start from an X-ray. We run sort of a standard long MD simulation. We take a representative.
So you break.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. So we take a representative.
For both states and then somehow.
From both states as well. So we run a long MD of the active of the model of the active state as well. and we take a representative structure of that simulation as the target.
And then the program basically applies the forces to remain.
Applies the forces on those atoms that we asked to the program to calculate the RMSD.
Okay.
Okay, so it can be all atoms of all the C alpha atoms basically. can be the C alpha of all the C alpha atoms, all the C alpha atoms of only some domains. The domains that we believe that they are
then
involved in the motion, yes.
Which force field do you normally use?
For these ones, the Amber 99, yes. IOPM, yes.
And you use the Amber program?
For this one, no, it's NAMDI.
NAMDI,
yes. But it's also possible with Amber as well.
Yeah, force field, I guess.
I have another question. For this coarse grain method, which I understand, for example, that you use it for longer time scales and also
yes.
to
yeah.
calculate, for example, assemblies or organization,
right.
You treat, so you take whole groups and you treat them as
yes.
a single
yes.
entity, as a single atom. What, yeah. what are the empirical functions, energy functions that you use for this?
This is the type of function for the coarse grain model is very similar, maybe the same type of the actual parameters of these energy terms of
yeah.
the change.
Yeah.
So the bond between two particles
okay.
is not as strong as the bond between two
okay.
actual atoms, right? So somehow scaled.
But you use essentially then the same.
The same energy function, yes. The same energy function. That's right.
I follow up
yeah.
on that question. And in the example you showed with the liquid,
yeah.
did you actually use only four types of?
That's right. It's the coarse grain model. Yeah, yeah. It's the coarse grain model that I showed the DBPC.
So basically,
model.
There are four types of atoms. Let's
four
say.
Types of yeah, beads atoms.
Yeah, do you do it in an implicit solvent or?
It's explicit.
It's
explicit.
But
solvent.
Also, one bead is one.
It's one bead is the water. Yes, that's right. The oxygen.
One question for me. You talked about drug gene delivery systems.
Yes.
What sort of systems are these?
This is somebody, my colleague Evi Gierka from the Academy studying. So it's like gold nanoparticles. So gold, so there's a way to construct
yeah.
a sphere of gold atoms
yeah.
and then decorate it.
Yeah.
Around with some functional groups like, you know, charged or uncharged.
Okay.
And then see how this can go through the binder.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah. Because it's a very, very, you know, this the translocation of the nanoparticles to the vapor can take, I don't know, even seconds. It's absolutely impossible to do it atomistically. So that's why the people doing it. Of course, the quantities that you get, the free energies have to be interpreted very carefully, but quantitatively and semi-quantitatively you get quite good results.
I mean, I know that, for example, for the delivery of, for example, genes and so on, there are molecules that have been developed for example, amphiphilic molecules and collaborating.
Like cyclodextrins.
Yeah, but not only. I mean, there is
yes.
various things and many of those I cannot tell you what exactly they are because they are secret and so on. But, I mean, could you also do, for example, a calculation or if this, how this molecules and the drug?
You could do it as long as there are, as long as coarse graining rules have been developed for these molecules.
Yeah,
because for now we have. For lipids, for proteins,
yeah.
And we have for sugars.
Yeah. Ah, yeah.
Okay, we have for DNA, but not for other.
So this will be based then on experiments. I mean,
the what?
The rules. These rules must be based on some sort of basic biochemical.
Yes,
or
basic the chemical structure of the actual molecule.
Yeah.
Yeah, so.
Okay. Are there any other questions? So, thank you very much, Dr. Patakas.